Somebody's striking a box, reported building fire. That's a reported building fire. Response will be engine 3, engine 16, engine 11, engine 8, ladder 2, ladder 6, rescue 1, car 3, ladder 3, surrender.
What qualities make a good firefighter? They have to be physically fit. They have to be of good moral character. They have to work well as a team, because everything we do is basically based on teamwork. And they have to be able to follow orders and work under intense situations and keep their wits about them.
You feel the heat change in our tanks?
They can't have any fear of heights. They can't have any fear of confined spaces or losing sensory perception, because we have a physical job. And you have to be smart enough to be able to study the information. And another quality that we look for in the recruits here, you have to be aggressive. Basically type A personalities, because we're asking you to put your life on the line. And that's just the way it is.
The NFPA, the National Fire Protection Association, requires that 4 firefighters respond to any fire call within 3 minutes of getting the call. To do that requires manpower. With attrition and retirement, Worcester needed more manpower. The solution? A new recruit class. In 2012, Worcester received funding to train 31 applicants. All 31 passed. This is the story of how they became city firefighters, as seen through the eyes of 4 of the recruits and their chief training officer.
Boots is referred to as the new guys. It's a nickname I guess they got from way back in the day, and it just kind of sticks for the new guys.
When I got the letter, I think I didn't even get the letter, actually. It was my wife who opened the mail, and she told me that that the Worcester Fire Department was looking into me. So I think she was very excited when she told me, and then it was a good moment.
I think the biggest thing that drew me to a job like this is camaraderie and brotherhood that exists. There are a few other jobs out there that have those unique characteristics.
I've always thought about being a firefighter, and the job always interested me, and I enjoy helping people.
Our job is so labor intensive that we have to have bodies in place to get the job done. The fewer people we have working with us, the longer it takes us to complete a task.
I wanted to become a firefighter because I thought it would be a great opportunity to help within the community. I'm a person that loves to assist and work with people, and I thought it would be a great platform to do so.
Thought long and hard, and some of my friends did it as well, and I just felt it was a great job, a very admirable job, where you get to help people and really make a difference.
I've been new to several different things throughout my life. I was in the military, so I was new to that. That was similar. I played sports my whole life, so I was always a new guy on a team.
Say when the fire is growing and we're trying to make entry into a building, the faster we can accomplish that, the better chance we have of either making a rescue or making a quick stop on that fire.
I see them out in the field doing their thing, and I always knew they stayed in shape. I always saw they loved staying healthy and helping out the community. And it just seemed like it almost seemed like I was always big into sports, and it seemed like a team thing to get the job done.
I had some mixed feelings. My mom was obviously worried a little bit just because of the type of job it is. But it made my family very proud to know that I was going to go into this line of work.
Civil Service sends us a list, which we work off of. It would have, at the top of it, would have any firefighter who had a parent who was killed in the line of duty. Below that, we'll have disabled veterans. Below that, veterans, and then anybody who's a non-vet will fall below that. What we basically do is we have to start doing background checks.
The Civil Service exam. And then it was a few months before, I want to say almost close to a year, before we even heard anything back. The whole process was probably 2 years.
When I first applied, it was a long process from soup to nuts, from the very, the interview and the PAT. And then drill school, I love drill school. It was fun because, you get 31 guys and we're all in the same boat.
I have the opinion I won the lottery when I got on this job. I got to do what I wanted to do my whole life. You can't ask for anything else. It was never, never a chore for me to come to work. It was always a pleasure. And I loved every guy who worked with. Okay? Look around the room. They're your friends. They're your buddies for life. Believe me.
I think I was pretty nervous. I felt very blessed and fortunate to be on the academy.
It was tiring. We go in, we do our physical training, which was a couple hours in the morning. You know, we'd be dragging big tires around and climbing the drill school. And then we'd take a quick shower, do a couple hours of classroom in the morning, and then we'd have quick lunch, and then usually we'd go out to the drill yard. And that's where we did, you know, our live burns.
It starts pretty much classroom. I would say it probably, in the beginning, it's 50-50. And then as we get more into the deeper aspects of the job, which is firefighting, they'll be spending more time outside.
We start with physical training in the morning. A course that we had to take, and you just, I believe it was like 10 practical fitness things you would have to do, and you have to complete them on a certain time. To make sure you were fit to do the job. Then we would get into the classroom setting. We had tests weekly.
Challenging part was the classroom, because it was a lot of studying, a lot of reading, and it seemed like it was test after test, and there wasn't much time to, you just had to, as soon as you got out of classroom, you had to keep studying for the next part.
How much studying would you have to do a night to be able to keep up with everything you had that was going on?
I would get home, eat dinner, and I would hit the books for at least 2-3 hours a night.
And what sort of things were in those books that you had to look at?
Well, there's so much involved. We hit from ladder operations, engine operations, so many things that we did. I can't even explain how many things we hit.
Non-stop. But it was, you know, there wasn't a minute throughout the day that we weren't learning something in one fashion or another, you know, and it was always something branched off each other.
And what we usually do is we break them up into teams, so usually like five or six people, depending on the size of the class that we're putting on, and where we'll have instructors, one instructor for each group, so that we can break them apart. At times they'll work together in unison to perform when they're fighting the fires inside the burn building. Other times they're doing individual training, whether it's raising ground ladders, whether it's putting up aerial ladders, using the aerial equipment on the job, or laying hose lines, car fires. So we break it down so that they basically are getting individual training, as opposed to everybody just sitting in a class and just listening.
Well, we show up to work, make sure the house is clean, check the truck, we'll go do inspections, come back, train, and do our calls, you know, and that's the extent of the day, and you know, we're always doing stuff to keep busy and always making sure that there's something that we can brush up on, and mixed into that is going out on our calls and doing our job.
The task that we had to do in training that made me most nervous was climbing the 100-foot ladder. I found that, you know, I wanted to know the day we were doing it just so I could mentally prepare, and I kind of wanted to get it over with. But as the day came, you know, we went out, looked at the ladder, and they kind of joked around and said, all right, you know, we're going to climb this later on. And so there was a little bit of tension building up, and everyone was nervous. I was very nervous. And once I get out there, they raise the ladder, and it seemed forever. I've never had to climb something like that. I just kept climbing. I got like 3/4 of the way up. I looked down, and I thought I was almost there. I wasn't. Kept climbing and climbing. But it also, you know, it kind of taught me where just to kind of think, but also do it. And then when you accomplish it, it's kind of a little mind over matter. I think a lot of it is a mental game. So you know you're safe, you go nice and slow, and then before I knew it, I was at the top, looking at the monster fish in the pond next to the drill school. So It was a good feeling climbing to the top and saying, wow, this is amazing, I actually did it. And then climbing down and, you know, even out of everyone, all 31 people, everyone climbed it, no problem.
When we took our first hydrant, you know, they showed us the way, the practical way of taking a hydrant, explained why you do certain things. And then after that, we would do it, and we actually went one at a time, we'd take the hydrant.
Well, they give you a green shield for your first year so that when you're at a fire or at an incident, like all the people know that you're a new guy there, just in case they look out for you, you know? It's kind of like a sign that, you know, if you're by yourself, they'll know to help give you a hand or give you some direction.
Someone watching from the outside might look like a lot of stuff's going on, but, you know, as long as, and which there is, but as long as each person focuses on what they have to do, it all comes together and it all works out for the better.
And we want people who are qualified and want to do this job and want to work and are not afraid to work. We want them here to learn, and if you don't want to learn, then you shouldn't be here. If you're not going to here to do the job, then you're going to get weeded out. It starts fairly quickly that we get them out in the burn building.
Your vision is greatly compromised, so it's all feel, right? It's the hands, where your partners are, right?
This is fantastic. We were able to, you know, simulate some situations that were similar to ones that we've all already experienced. So this is well worth it.
Let's go, move, fellas, move, fellas. Get down, get down. Yeah, stay low, fellas. Everybody okay?
We can run them through a maze. We did have a flashover. The Mass Fire Academy has a flashover trailer that we brought down to experience that. They have a maze trailer that we can bring down, so we put them in non-threatening situations, but we darken it out and we make a maze, and I mean, that's what the job is. So if you're not comfortable doing that, going through a maze, then you're not going to make a good firefighter.
So as we get an oxygen being the inhibitor of fire, we're going to start getting better visibility because the fire is just going to burn hotter.
The flashover chamber is good because it allows you to see the characteristics of a fire leading up to a flashover. You don't want to be in a flashover because if you're more than 5 feet in the room, chances are you're not coming out. So it shows you the tongues of fire going through the smoke, and that's a sign that the room is building up to a flashover stage. So that is the benefit of them seeing that, because if they're in a building and they happen to see these telltale signs of a flashover looming, then they can get themselves out of that building in a hurry.
We did a lot of live burns, so they have the burn building in the city, and we'd be the engine company. We'd be given an incident, so they would describe, say, if it's a fire showing, they would tell us what the assignment was, and we would have to handle it appropriately.
Each group would have various roles, so we might have, first an engine, which would attack the fire, then we'd have a supply engine, the second an engine would lay a supply line and secure a water source for the first engine, and we also have a ladder truck as well to do those tasks, to ventilate and to do a search. And it was good because we'd have to coordinate all the efforts, and also, you know, we'd listen for orders from the chief, and we'd execute them, and it was a good good training for the real world.
Every call is different, so you learn from every single call you go to on what equipment to take. If it's a gas call, you're on the ladder, you gotta know to take the meter, and if you're on an engine, you gotta know what type of call it is, what to take for tools.
You know, you put the mask on, and you have your SCBA, and you have your face piece on. It took a little while to adapt to that, because I had never had anything like that on before. But then I seem to forget about it.
We've had a few small structure fires that have gone through, one multi-alarm fire, and it was quite an experience and pretty exhilarating, each and every one of them. We would all get in the trucks and pull right up to the building as we were approaching a residential property. And just pretend like it was real, and every action that took place was similar to what's really done out there.
We can set up different scenarios with the burn building we have now that we couldn't in the past with the tower that I actually had when I come on the job, which was just a single tower with a stairway going up through it. We have multiple rooms here, we have multiple floors, we have confined spaces. Probably the one that's going to be telltale is how they make out in the maze trailer, how they handle a situation where they've lost their ability to see and hear, and they're alone, and they have to try and find their way through this trailer. Coupling that with burn building, which is basically the same thing, but now it's a little bit more intensified because now you have a fire situation. You know there's heat in that building. You know there's a fire somewhere. You're just not sure what room it is, and you're not even sure where the rooms are. So that would probably be the most difficult aspect of the recruit training that they go through. We have safety officers. We have people in there with thermal images just watching the recruits when they're doing their evolutions through the burn building. So they know they're safe. They know they're not going to get hurt. So they're learning, and they're facing these conditions that they've never experienced in their life in a safe manner. And then when they go out and they actually experience it under structure fire, they're better able to deal with it because they've already been through some of those same issues that you're going to deal with when you're in a building. A lot of it has to do with the synthetics we deal with now. We have hotter burning fires, we have more intense fires. We also have better equipment that we wear now that allow us to go deeper into a building and closer and into more heated and dangerous situations and still not feel the effects of it because we're so well protected now. It's much more regimented. Part of it was the fire that Worcester experienced where we lost the 6 guys. So that intensified our training. We got better equipment. We got thermal imaging cameras now. And the EMS aspect of the job also with using the defibrillators and so forth. So there's a lot of technical aspects of the job. Our job has grown. I mean, there's a lot more technical aspects to it with the hazardous materials that we're dealing with on a constant basis. With technical rescues, whether it be a confined space, building collapse, trench collapse, there's a lot of standard operating procedures across the country that we have to meet. We can't just go and do things off the cuff. We have to really understand what we're doing because people are watching, and if something goes wrong, then somebody's going to have to answer for that.
I have a cousin, Ruben Guadalupe, who is a firefighter for 10 years. He's a great person, and he always pushed me to try to get on the fire force as well. It was a great influence for me.
Is he with the city department?
He is. He's actually at this station as well at Franklin on Engine 6.
When you told him you were going to apply, what was his reaction?
He was actually pretty thrilled. He's actually after me for a while to try to apply. He told me he enjoyed the job, liked the camaraderie. He enjoyed helping people, and he thought it was the greatest job ever.
My father-in-law is actually a firefighter, and he's been on for a good while, and when I just got married last year to his daughter, so it's pretty neat that she experienced growing up with her father on, and now she knows the job for her husband, you know.
What sort of advice did he give you when you wanted to apply?
He just said, you gotta really try your hard. It's a real hard competition. There's so many people that go for it. He said, the only thing you can do is just make sure you study and stay in shape and give it your best. All his friends are firefighters, so, and now mostly all my friends are firefighters.
Children watch their parents, and a lot of times what happens is they obviously can see how happy they are doing their job and talking about what they do for their living and that they're helping people. And that is what we do. We go and help people at the worst possible moment.
You know, it's been a great career. I got Joe and I, in fact, came on together. Chief Henderson to you guys. We came on together, and it was all, you know, like you almost had instant buddies because your dads worked together, and, you know, it was just a great thing.
It's like one big, it's your family at work, and then outside of work, you're hanging out with firefighters too, so it feels like it's one big family, you know?
So kind of eat, drink, and sleep it.
Pretty much.
I think the legacy that's in this city is probably holds the most value, holds the most weight.
Worcester has such an extensive history with firefighting. Worcester is diverse, and it has a lot of different areas. So you got to really see the different parts of Worcester, the different demographics. I really enjoy. We put the water on the fire, so to speak, and we're the first in to lay, or first in to fight the fire.
I guess to give back to the community, be able to help people within the community. I think it's the proudest moment for myself.
Camaraderie, someone watching from the outside might look like a lot of stuff's going on, which there is, but as long as each person focuses on what they have to do, it all works out for the better.
I can reach out and help the community, not only at work, but also when I'm out and about and they find out you're a firefighter, it's a good feeling that like kids look up to you, and it feels great.
People are very appreciative. And also too, we had a fire drill at the school down the street, and just seeing the kids, as they walk in, they're all smiles when they look at you, and you give them a wave and they all wave, and it's just, it's a very admirable job. And even sometimes I get proud when I'm just on the truck and someone looks and waves, and we're going to a first responder or whatnot. I think it's the feel of being a firefighter. There's definitely times where I go to a scene or I hear a call, and the reality of the call actually kind of settles in, where there's sometimes that I think about it and it scares me. But I think a lot of it too is kind of mind over matter in trusting your equipment, trusting your crew, and just kind of doing the task that you have to do.
It's an exciting job. It's intense, and it's a nice feeling to know that you can rely on the person next to you, that you can put your life in their hands, and just be comfortable with that. And you can also, again, that you're out there helping people, and at the worst possible moment, you're there for them. And that's probably the most rewarding part of the job. The men who just went through the recruit class and everybody else on this job knows that it is the best profession in the world to be a firefighter.
Look around the room. They're your friends. They're your buddies for life.
You go to put it on.
Usually work with.
Yeah, right.
So
So this is kind of a handy thing to have.
Change of heat in our air tanks. Nice little flashover. There we go. Coming down the left-hand side. Coming down the right-hand side. What's above us right now?